Good morning. It is a joy to be with you today to worship. Hopefully the worship is a little bit more joyful than the weather, but I'm glad we all braved the rain to be here, and it's good to see everybody. Let us pause and center ourselves for a moment as we begin worship together. Let us pray. God, we invite you into this space this morning. Be with us. Bind us together in your love. Open our hearts and open our minds to hear from you. And teach us to love as you love us. We welcome you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand and join me in the invitation to worship? Let us come together as part of God's beloved family. For we are all God's children. We have been faithful at times, and we have strayed at times from God's love.
But God has never given up on us, always awaiting our return home.
So let us celebrate today in God's home.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Would you turn to number 545 in your hymnal for our opening hymn?
Victorious shall be the church
at rest. Yet she honoreth have union with God, the three in one, and mystic sweet communion with those whose rest is won. Oh, happy ones and holy, Lord, give us grace that we, like them, the meek and lowly, on high may dwell with thee.
And the congregation proclaimed, Amen. It is good that you're with us today, and I welcome you too to Calvary United Methodist Church. But my thoughts also go to those that are struggling with the weather in a much greater fashion than we are, which might be a tremendous inconvenience to some of us, but those on the East Coast are leaving their homes by the hundreds or thousands and maybe millions at this point this weekend and prep for the storms that are coming their way. So please remember them in our thoughts and our prayers and in our time of worship today. It is that moment in worship here, though, where we greet one another, we welcome each other, those that are among us, those who have come every year for such a long time, but those who might be here for the very first time. Let us greet and welcome each and every one, please. I know there's a number of children with us today. If the kids would make their way forward at this time, the young ones with us, if they would come forward, please. This is the time. And as they are coming forward, I also want to take a moment to give thanks for the Sunday school teachers that started today. We had multiple classes across the street in the Presbyterian Center, which over the next 2 years may be becoming quickly known as the Presbyterian Methodist Center as well. We had three different Sunday school classes there this morning that started at 10 o'clock, and a number of our children in multiple rooms, and also the adult class. Details are in the program, but I want to pause and give thanks to all the parents and to the teachers, and some of which are both categories, who helped make that possible. Thank you. Matt?
Guys? So I have a question. Who went back to school this week? Did you guys go back to school this week? No. When do you go back to school? You went back to, like last week. Okay. 2 weeks ago. Okay, you've been in school longer than I thought. When you went into your classroom on your first day of school, what are the first things that you noticed? Your teacher. What else? What else did you see? The classroom? What kind of stuff in the classroom? Work. It just looked like work right when you walked in, yeah. What other stuff did you see? When you went to school, when you went back to school, what are some of the things that you saw when you went into class? I want to think about teachers for a second. When you walked in and you saw your teacher, were they happy to see you? Yeah, were they smiling? Were they excited to see you? What do teachers do? Yeah. They teach. What does that mean? They give you work, but the work, they help you learn, yeah? Do they give you problems to solve? Do they ask you lots of questions? Do they encourage you to find the answers to the questions yourself? Do they give you all the answers? No, they don't, right? Did you know that the disciples called Jesus teacher? It's because when Jesus would teach the disciples, he wouldn't give them all the answers, but he would help them find the answers they were looking for. So I want us to think about how we can be teachers for others. And I'm going to give you an opportunity, because we're all teachers, to teach the grown-ups a lesson this morning. Can we teach them a lesson? We are going to teach the grown-ups out there the lesson of generosity. And so we're going to do that not by telling them the answer, but by giving them the opportunity to find the answer of generosity and give some money. So I'm going to ask you all to take a cup from right behind you there. And we're going to go out, and we are collecting money for the choir. Does anybody remember where the choir is going this fall? They're going to New York City. Yeah, they're going to go sing. They're going to go out and on tour and sing at Carnegie Hall. You're staying with Aunt Karen during that. That's exciting. So I want you all to go teach the adults a lesson and collect some money for the choir as they go out on their trip. I hope you're all willing to learn how to be generous. Heard the phrase, it's so quiet you can hear a pin drop, but in here it's so quiet you can hear a coin drop. I like that sound. Yeah, put your hand up if you have some money to give to the kids. All right, and when your cups are full, you can bring them back up, and we'll dump them all in here. And before you go, we'll say a quick prayer. Stack your. Oh. Thank you. All right. Can you guys say a quick prayer with me? I think we need to stack the cups. Let's say a quick prayer. Dear God, help us to learn from all those people who teach us, and help us to teach others to be kind and loving just like you taught us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. As we enter a time of prayer together, I want to invite you to share your prayers with the community, those joys and concerns that are on your hearts, and we will lift them up together by saying, Lord, hear our prayer. What joys and concerns do you have?
As you guys know, about over a week ago, I had my surgery at West Penn Hospital. Well, when I came through, the doctor came in my room, and he said everything went well, and I should make a 100% recovery from what was the problem.
And it's a joy as you continue to recover from your surgery. Lord, hear our prayer.
I ask for prayers for my sister-in-law, who's in Colorado. She has stage 4 breast cancer.
Callie, we lift up your sister-in-law and your family as she has been diagnosed with cancer. Lord, hear our prayer.
Prayers for Jana Schmaltz, as her sister passed away this week.
We lift up Janice and her family as they mourn the loss of her sister, Anne. Lord, hear our prayers.
Continued prayers asked for my former husband, who has been suffering from 2 forms of cancer and is still trying to find a reason for the continued illnesses that he's suffering right now. So we're just hoping things improve for the sake of my children. Thank you.
We continue to hold him in prayer. Lord, hear our prayers.
We would ask prayers for our daughter and the other teachers at the Athens High School in Ohio. A recent graduate just committed suicide, and the community there is struggling, and our daughter had her from kindergarten on.
We lift her up and for this community as they mourn this loss. Lord, hear our prayer.
There are a number of prayer requests in the bulletin each and every Sunday. Please take note. Just a few updates. Christine Thomas has had surgery, even though the bulletin says differently. She has also had 2 surgeries and is in rehab and is doing somewhat better and will be there for some time to come. So please keep Christine Thomas in your thoughts. Joe Ober's name we did not get a chance to get on there. Joe was in a car accident a few weeks ago, and that helped, if you would, in a way, bring forth some other concerns with his back. And he has had surgery, is recovering now at home, but is doing much, much better, and speaking with Joe just the last few days. And so we want to keep Joe Ober in our thoughts and in our prayers. There were 2 weddings, one on Friday this week and one yesterday. Alicia and Nathan were wed here, Hayden, on Friday evening, and Katie and Justin Theory were wed here yesterday afternoon. Remember them in your thoughts and in your prayers. And all of you are aware that at times I complain about the connectional system and its weaknesses, but I need to make sure today that I prayerfully give thanks. On Friday, I had the horrible distinction and honor, in a way, to lead the funeral for our nephew's newborn daughter. She was only 13 days old when she passed because of a brain tumor. Isabel Ann was the name they'd given to her, and it was a memorial service, but also it was a celebratory service because they learned throughout the physician's care and other discoveries after her death that if she had been born when she was supposed to, she would have never made it. And so they had done a C-section 2 weeks earlier. And it was amazing to be in the presence of at least 40 to 50 individuals from the medical realm that had cared for this little girl. I don't know how they kept the hospital open on Friday afternoon. And the people from the works that both of the individuals, Sarah the mother and Adam the father, were all present. The connectional system, it took only 2 phone calls for your pastor to get a United Methodist pastor to go to the hospital within 90 minutes of this little baby's surgery. It took only one phone call after that to make all the arrangements for a service at a United Methodist Church. I want to give thanks to Grace United Methodist Church, our sister church, in Manassas, Virginia, that opened their doors and their entire staff to make it possible to have a service there for this young child. So prayers of gratitude this day and prayers of sadness in our household, in our extended family, but it was a wonderful example of how the United Methodist Church, in the midst of all its differences and all its challenges, can be the church. So with those thoughts and others I'm sure that you have as well this day, I'm going to ask if Frank would lead us now in the Unison Prayer. Frank, would you please, sir?
Lord, we pray today for the gathered community of faith. Through it, may we always learn to love and value life, and within, may we always find acceptance. Lord, we pray today for the wholeness of our faith, for we are not intended to be split and divided as people. So guide us as healing agents to bring peace and hope to a fractured world. Lord, we pray today for thy spirit to be present with us from birth through death into everlasting. Amen.
As we continue in a spirit of prayer, we take a moment to center our thoughts on those who are impacted by the back-to-school season for students and teachers and families. So I invite you to think of them as we pray now. Our God, our lives are marked by the changing of seasons. We take delight in these times and give you thanks for change, for newness, and for difference. These are periods of heightened expectancy and new growth, and we thank you. We thank you for the summers that we have all had, for the play and the relaxation, for the breaks and vacations, for time off and time away with family. We thank you for this chance to unwind and experience more leisure. And we thank you now for all the good events that lie ahead, for exciting classes and new friends for the students in our midst. God, we lift to you all students at every level as they go back to school and ask that this would be a good year for them, a year of growth. Let their learning be rewarding as well as challenging, and let them enjoy the growth that comes from new experiences. Give all students a spirit of joy and confidence and help them to live gratefully at all times, aware of the gift of life and its incredible richness. And we also lift up those teachers who will be guiding them on this journey. For those entrusted with imparting wisdom and guiding others, we ask your guidance. It is a holy and profound task to teach, and we give you thanks for those who have taken that burden and ask that you empower them and support them. We pray for the families of students and the families of teachers, knowing that the support systems in place are communities you have given us to help one another. As a church, we say a special prayer this morning for our Sunday school program, for the ways that we continue to learn and to grow as a community of faith. We pray that no matter our age, we would continue to be students of your teachings, finding ways to broaden our understanding of the things you teach us. So we thank you for those in our community who have sacrificed their time and energy to organize our Sunday school program and to teach us on Sunday mornings about your word and your will. We give you thanks, O God. And we come knowing that you are our great teacher, that we are all students at your feet. Teach us, O God, this day to love you. Teach us to love one another. Teach us to live as you would have us live. Teach us, O God, to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with you. grant us the wisdom that your Son embodied, so that we might go in turn to teach others of the love you have for our world. Open our hearts and our minds that we might internalize the lessons you have taught us, including the lesson on how to pray. So we now pray together the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You can tell that it is that time of the year by the thickness of the program and the bulletin this morning and all the announcements and activities. I want to just highlight a few, but there are two that are either not there or there is a mistake. Tuesday, choir begins. However, or no, choir began last Tuesday. Tuesday, choir will be again. On Wednesday is the adult Bible study beginning this Wednesday. It is at 6:30. So Tuesday is choir, Wednesday is Bible study. On Thursday, Northside Common Ministries has a special event, but also church council is taking place this Thursday, the 13th. Is that correct, Frank? Am I remembering? And I think it says it's the 20th there. We were trying to juggle between two different dates. The majority of people can be here this Thursday, so it's this Thursday for church council. There are many other announcements, special concert, other things that are clearly there, and the Sunday school programs that we started today and their continuation. So with those thoughts, let us continue to give thanks now by sharing our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. Please let us stand. Each and every Sunday, Lord, we light candles. They are placed here upon your altar to remind us of the presence that you provide each and every day, that illuminates our lives with the possibilities and promises of hope, of faith, of love. And then we place gifts upon your altar and ask for this blessing so that they might continue to share that light with those in our own families, in our own church family, in our extended family, and around the communities of which we come and live in and work in, and the world in which you have given to all of us. May those blessings be, we ask and we pray. And everyone said, Amen. The choir has done a wonderful job throughout the summer. The different individuals you're looking at took turns, many of them, to bring special music. But now they're back together. It's great to have you here, gang. Thank you. Thank you so much, choir. It's really great to have you back with us. This morning, the scriptures are taken from two different chapters in the same book of Mark, and I've asked Frank if he would juggle those two to read it in its entirety. without reading the entire chapter. So, Frank, would you bring the text to us, please?
Reading from the book of Mark. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and be servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant. And he said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Don't stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it." And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. This is the word of God, written by the people of God, for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. It's this time of the year whenever clergy circles and the media that many of us are in tune with as pastors begin to ring with all kinds of examples about Sunday schools. Last year, for instance, Justin, a six-year-old, didn't seem to be paying attention in Sunday school that day whenever they were going over the creation story and Adam and Eve and how a rib was taken from Adam so that there might be a partner. You know the story. But a few days later, there was Justin. He had an intestinal stomach flu, and he said to his mother, "Mommy, my side hurts. I think I'm going to have a wife." 7-year-old Destiny told the entire class that next week she wasn't allowed to go to the Sunday school picnic because it had been a pretty rough week in her home. She had not been behaving. It was almost like confession. But she said that the night before, her parents had changed their mind, and she was doing so much better that she was allowed to go. And she said to the class, "But it's too late." Teacher asked why. And she said, "I've already prayed for it to rain all day long." Or 5-year-old Isaiah, my favorite, he announced to everyone in the class that he had lost his pet dog. The dog's name was Belker. And he said that my dad said that Belker was just 10 years old, but that was pretty good for a dog. And so I asked my dad, "How long will I live?" And he said, "Oh, don't worry, Isaiah, you're going to live a long time, much longer than Belker." And of course, he asked why. I loved his dad's answer. He said, "Because people have to learn to love everyone, and that takes a long, long time. But Belker, he was born that way." What did you learn in Sunday school? What opportunities do you recall as part of that experience as student or teacher or assistant, or as teen assistant in some cases these days? You know, historically, his name was Robert Rakes. That's who they give official credit to for helping to start Sunday school. He and his wife, Anne, they were in Gloucester, England. They had 10 children of their own. In fact, this coming week celebrates over 280-some years of Robert Rakes' birthday. He was born on the 14th of this month in 1736. But they were concerned about the other children. There were a good number of individuals, children, who were working every day of the week. Child labor was the rule of the land. They were poor, they were orphaned, there was quite a list of them. By 1780, though, Anne and Robert Raikes had made it possible for hundreds of children to be in school on Sunday. There were others, like John and Charles Wesley, in the new room and also in a place called Kingswood, and in a strange place they had visited, they even helped start an orphanage school in Georgia. By 1831, it is documented that over 1.25 million children were in Sunday school. Biblically, you can find in many ways in texts throughout the scriptures how important it was for children to be taught, how you could place the basic beliefs of this Christian movement, and how it took people. Deuteronomy chapter 11. Fix these words of mine in your hearts and minds. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Pretty clear. Joshua 4. When your children ask in time to come, what do these stones mean to you, then make sure that you tell them. Proverbs 23. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. No wonder the prophet Isaiah in chapter 11 proclaimed, a little child shall lead them. And all of us are aware of Luke 2, where Jesus is found teaching in the temple himself, and the temple leaders are unprepared, unsure, and unwilling to accept his teaching. And of course, the text today is one of the best known. And it could lead us to review childlike qualities and why we need to rediscover them and put them back into practice in our lives to be God's child of faith. It also could lead us to talking of the harshness that many children still experience. Historically, there are tremendous amounts of examples like the child labor in the 1700s and 1800s. But even now, what happens when we keep or take from children the essence of faith or of the ability to experience life in its fullness? Do you know, statistically, these days, 30,000 children die every day of malnutrition on this planet? Do you know that 10 to 12 million are homeless? In fact, the schools that we read in have an ongoing problem in the Pittsburgh area where children who are homeless attempt to attend school. No address, no contacts. Do you know that there is a child abused every 11 seconds in this country? And sadly to report, as all of you are aware, there have been a good number in churches. The media feeds on children in our society and their perceived wants and needs. And addiction today takes more and more children and young adults from us than almost any other concern. Oh, you could make a good case that the world is filled with ills that still hurt our children. Like the scripture that we were reading just a few moments ago, the disciples were quite busy. They were stressed out by all the things that were happening. I mean, come on, they had been all around Jerusalem and Galilee. They had been healing. They had been more demands for more healings and more teachings by the thousands, and then they had to try to feed them. How different factions in their own religious background now was trying to stop their rabbi from teaching and healing altogether. And now children? hardly a priority. But, you know, our scripture reminds us that Christ modeled for us how human relationships should be above everything else. Jesus was inviting not only the adults, but also in this case, and it is found in multiple gospels, by the way, the children. For you see, that's what I believe, and I think Christ did as well, really helps children, and that's to know that they belong, that they are cared for, that they are affirmed. They want to be persons, persons who are known, recognized, and cared for. In a wonderful way, Jesus was practicing what he was preaching. He took time in the midst of all the chaos to be with children, who are too often the chief, if you will, victims of our busyness. You know, I believe one of the biggest problems in our culture is often referred to as proper time management. And it's not because we have any less time than others. It's because the alternatives are so many. We have the money, we have the resources, we have the transportation, and we live in urban centers like this one. We have an unlimited number of things that can take our time. The opportunities can become a blur. There are so many of them. We can find ourselves in a maze of living, going from one thing to the next, trying to sort out not the hours or the days, but the minutes. I remember not too long ago, before I came here as a pastor, I was literally watching my clock for the seconds for meetings to be over and the next thing to take place. It's almost an illness. And yet the people nearest to us, the people dearest to us, go unmet, unanswered, underserved. And too often, they're the little people, our children. So I'm thankful that I'm at a church where we are focusing and not forgetting our children. I'm thankful I'm in a worship where we take time almost every Sunday to spend with our children. I'm thankful that we're looking at trying to expand our Christian education program, even though we don't have all the resources nor all the volunteers. I would want it no other way. Our loving and caring spirit, our understanding, our ability to be calm and to provide devotion to the young people among us is exemplary. It takes our time, it takes our patience, and those of us that have not been blessed with our own children, it also takes a heart bigger than the one we may have been given. You know, Dennis Campbell, a friend who was the dean at the Divinity School in Duke for years, had in one of his presentations this quote: "In this country, we are guilty of giving our children too much to live with, but not enough to live for." We are guilty of giving our children too much to live with, but not enough to live for. You know, whether it takes a village or whether it takes a few more quality minutes of our own personal time, today's scripture reminds us the primary need as the people of faith to give and to share with our children, all of them, not just the ones with the last name that might be similar or the same, but all of them. Now, I thought about concluding the sermon today perhaps by celebrating Fred Rogers, a Presbyterian pastor who this year, 50 years ago, started a wonderful ministry. We all know the song, "It's a Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood." In fact, if you walk out those doors on a nicer day, you could walk down the street and be present with a statue that honors what he did and what he still is providing for children. But instead, because that's so familiar to all of us, I'm going to challenge us with one final thought. Clay Christensen is a business professor at Harvard University. Well, he was some years ago. And there's a little clip that I found that Clay put together about religion and its responsibility and perhaps something that's becoming less and less possible in our synagogues and in our churches, and that's the care for our children. This little clip is only a couple minutes long, but I think it speaks to the scripture today in our setting, and perhaps a prophetic warning if we don't. Let's watch. You can't hire enough police. Wow, does that ring true? So today our scripture challenges us as the people of faith to make sure that we give attention to our children. Amen? Amen. Let us stand and sing the final hymn of the day.
Let the people rejoice. Oh, come.
Great things he has taught us, great things he has done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer, higher, and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, let the earth praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, all rejoice. To the Father, Jesus, the
as we go forth, all are invited to join us for a time of food and fellowship. I'm not sure as we have transitioned back into our fall routine if we'll be downstairs or not, but just follow the aroma. I'm seeing someone point downstairs, so I think we'll be downstairs, so please join us for that. Receive this prayer as a benediction. Lord, make us instruments of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light, and where there is sadness, joy. O divine Master, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Go in peace. Amen.